I know that all things are working for my good. Yeah, she's intentional, never failing. All things are
working for my good.
Cause she's intentional. Hey, and he's never failing. All things are working for my good.
Well, definitely, as Tanya will always say, in life, her masterpiece and everything else that she says in her introduction. But I'm going to start off first. I'm going to start off welcoming Sister Karen Dodd, the owner, the originator, the creator of Ruby Girl. That is what Brushstrokes is all about. Art is universal. It is its own masterpiece. So when you create it, you own the brush. You own the stencil. You own the crayon. You own the canvas that it is made on. It may be duplicated, however, you are the originator. I'm sending this on over to my dear sister friend, Coach Tamara J.
Hello, hello, hello. I am Coach Tamara J. I am so grateful, so thankful to be here with you on this amazing platform tonight, the Brushstroke Show, where we are kicking it brushstroke style. And I cannot wait to get into our intimate conversation tonight with our very own Ruby Girl on tonight. I'm going to pass the mic over to our very own host, Coach Tanya Bankston.
Yes, I am so excited to be here myself. You know, that's just like life and just like live. You have hiccups, you have things go wrong, and the Brushstroke Show is just about that. It's about talking about those zany color outside the life experiences that we all have, what I like to call brushstrokes. And it's all about taking those experiences and reframing them, refocusing, and taking them to help you to empower, to change your life. So tonight on our show, I am so excited to bring to you our special guest. And let me just read a snippet of her bio. Miss Karan Dodd, K as we call her, is the owner of His Designs LLC and the creator of the Ruby Girl brand, which is inspired by Proverbs 31:10. Who can find a virtuous woman? For her price is far above the price of a ruby. K is an ordained minister who loves to empower women with words of faith and encouragement. She is currently training to be a speaker at Sean's Fair Leadership 2021 Tour. She is the founder of Step It Up, which is a business group which focuses on building million-dollar businesses. Her Bible study support group is called Saved Intelligent Sisters, which was started by her more than 10 years ago. She has spoken at various conferences, encouraging women with her message, Class It Up, which gives women the courage to lift their standards and become what the Word has said that they shall be. At the age of 3, she was molested, and a year later, her mother was stalked and murdered by someone who proclaimed to love her. She was raised by her great-grandmother, who developed dementia when Kay was 12 and no longer was able to care for her. Kay was then forced to take care of her great-grandmother for 4 years. The anger of being forced to be in the house for 4 years caused her to separate from her family when she became an adult. God grabbed hold of her at the age of 29, and she reconciled with her family and was able to tell the person who allegedly murdered her mom that she forgave him. Kay wants you to know that Jesus heals. Kay, welcome to the Brushstroke Show.
Thank you. Thank you, Tanya. I am so excited to be on the show tonight. I really am.
I mean, okay, So let me just say this. I met Kay, I think it's been about 5 years.
It has.
Do you remember how we met?
Yes, I can never forget how we met. We met on the corner. Don't look at us strange. We met on the corner.
Yes. And talk about your brand speaking for you. Kay was at work, and I happened to be walking past her place of employment at that time. And the security guard said to Kay, what did he say?
You need to meet her. You need to connect with her. And we both was looking like, what? I don't know her. I don't know. You know, but we just like, okay.
He said, she just wrote a book. You need to buy the book. And that was how our relationship began. So Kay invited me to a business group that she is a part of. And it just took off. I am a part of Kay's Step It Up leadership group. And when I tell you that Kay is an amazing leader, to be up underneath her leadership, to be up underneath her leadership and be in that space where she is teaching me and I'm learning from her what leadership is all about, is truly, truly an amazing experience. But Kay, so what we want to do is we want to talk about some of your background, some of your brushstrokes. And I want to just say this to our listening audience, that we talk about difficult life experiences. It's never to exploit. It's never to take advantage of anyone, but it's to empower our audience and to empower people who may be going through difficult life circumstances. So Kay, tell us a little bit about your experience with your mother and that whole experience for you.
Well, I always like to go back to the initial trauma that I suffered. And I hear a lot of people saying, I don't remember what happened to me when I was 3 years old. Some people even say 4 or 5, but I remember everything. I remember what I was wearing that day. I remember what was said. I remember just a whole bunch of things about the experience. So I'm just going to tell you a little bit about it. So when I was 3, my father would watch me during the daytime while my mother worked. So I was one of those little kids that was always into stuff. And so I figured out how to get out the back door. So I went out the back door, and when I was in the backyard, I heard these voices. And so we lived in Mississippi. So in Mississippi was all these woods back there and everything. So I went back in the woods, and it was a hookup spot. And back there, it was adults doing what adults do. And so I'm 3, so I asked what they're doing. So this man was with this woman, and he was like, you want to find out? And so that's how I was molested. The lady, she didn't come to my rescue. She tried to. The man pushed her away, but it was really no effort for her. And so he just told me it was a game. And so, you know, I'm 3. I don't know any better. I'm thinking, I trust him. He's an adult. And that man took more from me than just my virginity that day. He took away my trust. He took away my self-esteem. And then he deposited in me demons that attracted other people to molest me as I grew older. And so after that, at the age of about 4, the timeline is a little sketchy because my family kind of like don't talk about it. My mother and my father got into it. My father was a very jealous man, very jealous. He even told me he used to hide up under my mom's house and wait for her to come home, hoping she'll bring home a man so he could shoot her, because he would have a shotgun with him. But luckily, my mom never did. So one day he stabbed her. He stabbed her so many times that she had on a nurse's outfit. It was totally red. So when she recovered from that, she left, went to Milwaukee. He followed her there, and he was stalking her there. And so he convinced her to go to Chicago with him. And after that, she was found dead. So my family always told me that my father had killed my mother. And so that's what I had to deal with as a child, that trauma.
Oh, my God.
Oh, my Lord. From the age of 3, one traumatic event, to the age of four, another traumatic event. And if you were to really look back over the course of your life, go from four all the way up to where you are to age 29, where you had to reconcile, those are feelings, those are thoughts, those are somewhat suppressed memories. Those are things that happen to you that, as people would say in the Black community, don't talk about that.
Yes.
Don't say anything. You know, I just recently had a discussion with my mother about an incident that happened to me when I was 5 years old. And I told her that I was going to write about this particular incident of being taken advantage of. And I talked about it in great detail. You know, the first thing she said, don't want to talk about something else. Okay. That's the problem. I need to get this hair on my face. That's the problem that happens in families, is that they don't want people to talk about it.
And see, I didn't tell my family until I was grown, because my family was already going through the trauma of losing my mom. So I didn't need to tell them something like that. And at the time, I didn't think it was wrong, because in my mind at three, I was, I guess, conditioned to see it as a game, that it was okay, that there was nothing wrong. And so I fought more so with that guilt of not, you know, I would hear people say they were molested, and they was like, oh, I was traumatized at the time. But at the time, honestly, I was not traumatized. I thought it was a game. So I lived with that guilt, like, did you enjoy that at 3 years old? And so I had to process that in my mind also. And it took me until I was adult and somebody took a three-year-old child and said, look at this child. Does this child look like somebody that would consent to adult act? That it finally clicked in my mind that you were violated. That was not a game. And because you didn't, you know, react to it like everybody else react, does not mean that it was any better than what happened to anybody else. That it was more your fault. It wasn't. And like you said, my family, I couldn't talk about it with them. Even now, I only told just a few family members. They hear it when I do my testimony. But you're right. The first thing the guy told me was, don't tell nobody. Wow. And as kids, we keep secrets better than adults do.
Yeah. I just, Ms. Karan, I just commend you, number one, on your bravery. Even now, even at three, I celebrate your brilliancy of being a three-year-old and being able to carry such a heartbreaking matter. That really tells me, as Coach Tanya shared about your leadership, and not that I'm sharing that trauma makes great leaders, you know, but you are a first responder. You're what we call a first responder. And to deal with being a first responder in so many times in your life, being a first on scene witness, not just approaching a scene, but experiencing it. And then being 3 years old tells me the stuff that God has really made you up of. And then to carry such a care so young and a concern for your caregivers and your caretakers, where you were able to say, I did not want to give them this pain, because at such a young age, your spirit self knew already that they were already dealing with things. Yes. But what resilience. I mean, really, what resilience. And so in this moment, I really sincerely celebrate the stuff you are made of. And I can truly see why you are here and present in this time, and why you have been called forward for such a time as this. I say to you, Ms. Karan, magnificent. Not what happened, but the traumatic post-growth that we are seeing demonstrated on the brilliancy here on this platform. I salute.
Thank you.
She said salute. We salute. Okay?
I salute right back at you. It's a journey.
Yes.
I mean, Kay's spirit is so, you just, to know her is to love her. I don't know anybody who does, who comes in contact with her and they're not actually just gravitated to her, because she just has a loving, caring, gentle spirit. But Kay, let me ask you, was there ever a point where you felt anger, a lot of anger or resentment, or did you ever find the need to get counseling?
You know, I never got counseling. I always felt like I needed counseling, but I kind of like tried to work through my issues. But yes, it was an anger moment, and it will shock you when I found out that I had unforgiveness towards my father. The reason that I had unforgiveness towards my father was so simple. I didn't even know. I was going through deliverance. And so the minister asked me, he said, "You have unforgiveness towards your father." And he said, "Forgive him." And I was like, "No." He was like, "Forgive him." I said, "No." And it was just a little girl in me. And so when I went home, I processed it. I was mad at him, not because I always thought he killed my mother. I was mad at him because he did not watch me good enough and protect me from going out in that backyard and getting molested. I never knew that till I went through deliverance. It had nothing to do with him and my mom. It had everything to do with, if you had just watched me, if you just paid attention to how I changed after this happened to me, this wouldn't have kept happening to me. Because after that, he decided to send me to a babysitter. They live next door to us. So while I was at the babysitter's son molested me. So my father came home one day, found me in the house, locked in the house. I had left their house, grabbed a chair. I remember this. I'm still three, y'all. Keep this in mind. And I got the key out. And I went in the house and locked myself in there. And I told him I was never going back up there. So I went from one situation to another, but my mind processed it like, this is your father's fault.
So as I sit here and think about how many little girls like you had gone through that and did not come out of it,
yeah,
with their mind, their body, their spirit, their sanctity. Some girls are not with us because, as we know, as mental health therapists, a lot of people commit suicide, or I should use the right term, die by suicide because of that. Tell me, where was the point in your life that you said, I know this is unnatural, this doesn't feel right? When did your life finally turn around after all of that?
Well, I got saved at 29. I finally turned my life completely over to God, and God began to deal with me. So at the age of 30, God began to tell me, go find your father, go find your father. Now, mind you, I have not seen my father since I was 3 years old. And like, mm-hmm. after probably about four. So after my mom had been killed, you know, my family kept me away from him and his family because they were scared that he was going to kidnap me. So I kind of had a fear of him growing up. And so the Lord was like, go find your dad. So I found my dad. And so I didn't have a conversation with him about what happened. I was just happy. I had a dad. You know, I was no longer an orphan. I had a dad. But it began, the anger began to rise in me. And finally, I was angry at him for what my family said he did to my mom. So I had a conversation with him. I asked him, was you with my mom the night I died? I can't disclose the answer, of course. And so I told him this. I said, I have to honor you because the Bible says I have to honor you because you're my parent. And I said, I'm going to honor you. I said, but I'm going to forgive you too for anything that you did to my mom, because it's between you, her and God. And you have to live with if you did anything to my mom. And so after that, I still had them feelings of anger. And I went back and visited him again. And when I visited him again, we spent some time together. And when I left there, I could actually say I spent time with my dad. It was no longer my father, but my dad. It was just a release. So it was God making me loose that, because it was doing no good to me, my family. My family was stuck. They just couldn't get past the moment that my mom had died. Her brothers and sisters was just like stuck in a pattern. And I felt like I didn't want to be in that pattern. I had to let it go. So that was my turning point when God began to tell me this happened to you when you was 3. And he said, I was there. He said, because think about it. Like you said, it's plenty of other little girls that died. He said, you didn't die. I kept that man from killing you. He said, you're not heartless. You are compassionate. All this that happened to you has helped shape your heart like it is. And that's why you have the passion that you have for people that hurt and always want to help people and always want to be given. So it could have just made me an angry, cruel person, but it did the opposite.
Wow. Another thing I know for a lot of women that I have encountered is that when they undergo traumatic sexual abuse like that at such a young age, there's a spirit of homosexuality or lesbianism that begins to attach itself to them. Did you have that type of experience where you just were like just turned off by men and didn't want to date or be involved with men or anything like that as a result of that?
It was the opposite for me, because growing up, I didn't have that mother father love. I just had my great grandmother love. And then when she got dementia at 12, that was gone. Then I stayed with my auntie, which she was emotionally abusive. So I didn't have that love. And so I always wanted men to hold me, to, you know, feel that love. And the only way I could do it was sex. So I became promiscuous, I would say. And so it was like anybody wanted to, I was fine with it. I didn't have any boundaries because I never got to set any. And so that's what happened to me. It was like I was having sex to find love. I just thought if you had sex, he had to hold you. He had to tell you that he loved you.
Wow. Can I say something right there? Mm-hmm. Man, Ms. Grant, I can relate. I dare not make this moment about me, but I can relate. And one thing that
I appreciate you working with us tonight as we kind of go through this platform. As you know, with the bloopers and everything else, when you go live, things happen. But I'm just going to say this about the Ruby Girl. I know you have a signature when it comes to the Ruby Girl. And my dear sister is wearing this shirt. Of course, you can't see mine, but everything you make has the ruby, the red ruby. And tell us about how did Ruby Girl come to birth?
You would not believe it. It's Facebook's fault. So one morning I was getting ready to post, and all of a sudden Ruby Girl just flew out from my fingers. And I said, Ruby Girl. And then God had me post Proverbs 31. And 10. And from there on, Ruby Girl was birthed. But I had been getting up asking God, give me something to get off my job. Give me a vision, you know, that I can impact people with. And he gave it to me that morning.
I never knew that. I never, ever knew that. Wow. I mean, and I see it such like a restoration. You know what I'm saying? Because your countenance, Kay, is just so, it's so pleasant. It's so reassuring. And a lot of times when people in the world see Ruby Girl, I know with your brand, people think that it's like a bling bling. It's And it's, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And I mean, you have to explain to them and give you the opportunity to talk about what the Bible says a woman is, you know, a priceless, virtuous woman.
Yes.
So, yeah, wow, that's, I never knew that.
Yes, and you know what I love about Ruby Girl, and what shocks me about it is that a lot of people are like, I don't know about Proverbs 31 and 10. That's all I learned every Women's Day in church. You was a virtuous woman. It was about the virtuous woman. But the church has gotten away from teaching about being a virtuous woman. A lot of women don't know how to be ladies. They don't know how to class it up. Because I think about when I was in my 20s, I dressed sexy, but I didn't show body parts because I had a certain level of class about me. And a lot of these young ladies don't have that level of class. They like to be ratchet. And I'm like, God did not create you like that. You were God's last creation. You are special to God. God put something in the woman. He made sure we was not made out of dirt. It's a certain level of cleanliness, ladylikeness that we bring into the world. And that stands his slip. I mean, I have to say, the music we listen to degrades us, but don't degrade men. Have y'all ever thought about that?
Exactly. You are so right. And when I think of Ruby Girl, I think of your personalized stationery. You know, I remember Felicia and the nice little rubies and a diamond that was on a particular postcard. Yes, Tanya Bankston. So, and when I thought about the ruby, I started to think about jade. I started to think about the turquoise, the other stones. But way back in the swing days, the 20s and the 30s and the 40s and the 50s, women were wearing rubies.
Wow.
They were wearing rubies. That's a precious stone. So tell us, now you told us how Ruby Girl was birthed, but tell us now more about the products, because as I understand, here in the upper chest is a woman's endowment, right? So we used to put money just right here, but now you have a little special pocket where women can put their money and keep it safe. So this is the Brushstrokes show.
This is my TikTok.
So the Lord also gave me the vision of the bra wallet. So the bra wallet, I'm wearing the Ruby Girl one. My first one was Tough Girl, which is the one that Tanya got. And that was birthed off, it was based off Philippians 4:19, because I'm like, we go through so much. We some tough women, you know, we tough girls. But this one is a Ruby Girl. It has a clip. It clips to your shirt. You can put it to your bra strap or whatever. And so it's made so that it zips down. So, you know, when you bring it out, you don't have to worry about everything falling out. So you put your credit card ID keys in here and you put it in there and you just go, and it's secure too. And so it was invented because this is why it was invented, y'all gonna laugh. So I used to sit at work and I would watch my coworkers go to the bathroom, so I could always tell when it was that woman's time of the month. So they would come by with something under their arm like this, or, you know, they got something folded up like this. And I was like, and I would just sit there and watch them. So I originally created this so women could carry their feminine products. Cause I was like, you know, like one time at work, I thought I was high minds. I looked back and they had fell on the floor. So I was like, I don't want that to happen to anybody. But then it turned into the bra wallet. I was showing it to this guy. He said, oh, that's a bra wallet. And I was like, there you go.
But wait a minute. Let me say this. First of all, this one, if you can see this one. So this one, I have been carrying this one for 4 years. 4 years. I have clipped it inside my bra. And as you can see, it's on the thick side. But the thing that I like about this product, I bought it because I was taking a trip to Vegas and I didn't want to be on a strip and, you know, be bothered with carrying a purse. I wanted my money and my ID. and other credit cards and all that kind of stuff. So I clipped it on and I've never taken it off. I mean, of course I've taken it off to shower and all that kind of stuff, right? But it has been durable. It falls on your chest a certain kind of way so it doesn't look bulky or anything like that. People don't know that it's there. It's safe. And I mean, I bought several of them to give them away and to bless other people. And yeah, I can't say enough about it. I have used this consistently. Coach Tamir J is trying to get in there. Let's let her say something.
Well, I don't want to rewind, but I appreciate, you know, just the transparency in her story, because as I was going to say before the interruption was, we live in a world that labels women who they are not aware they're living with trauma. And sometimes the women themselves, as you mentioned earlier, we can suppress and block out trauma as a way of protecting ourselves so that we can try to function in this crazy world as best as possible. But we live in a society that is what I like to say addicted to labeling, judging, demeaning women who have a pain behavior of being promiscuous because they are unaware of their self-worth. And we'd like to talk about these women like myself. Call them Jezebels, call them home wreckers. And I'm not saying that their behavior is valid. I'm not saying that it's excusable. But I'm saying that when we begin to understand how trauma abides in the brain and what it does to the human soul, what it does to the human heart, what it does to the human body, and we understand it in its real essence, that it hijacks a person's rationality. And I literally mean that a person is not who God intended them to be. Now, that is not mistaking the pain that it causes. However, keep in mind I've never heard a loving message about Hagar in the Bible. Hmm. Never heard a loving message. However, she was intertwined in a relationship that she never really asked to be in, but she is always the culprit. Huh. You know, her choice hijacked. You know, even the God we serve commanded her, go back and face it. You know, and so there are women who come from where I come from, and you know, Ms. Crum, where you say dealing with that challenge of being promiscuous, I would love to see us have more conversations to support those of us who have been labeled in that way and then demeaned in that way. And some glorify it. However, the way that you shared your story just helps me, and I'm sure other women who may be hiding still, yeah, recognize that there is a way and that there is beauty for those ashes too. So I say thank you on behalf of us all.
Oh, that's beautiful, Tam. Very, very beautiful. Beautiful. Sister Kay, now this is the time and the hour that you blossom into this beautiful ruby girl. And I know you are blessing so many rubies out there. Okay. So tell us about that jacket that is right behind you that says Ruby Girl.
Actually, this business owner, Melissa Major, or Major Fresh Fashion, contacted me and said she was doing business. She was doing business jackets. So she did one for me, Ruby Girl. So it gives me an opportunity to start conversations with people and then also to give them a Ruby Girl card, which I was giving out a lot of them before COVID. And the cards was just to lift up women. You know, a lot of women would read and say, oh, my God, thank you. I really need this. Because how many women, you just randomly in the store and somebody give you a card that says what your worth, what your value are, and how beautiful you are. So.
You know, one thing about the Brushstroke Show, all of us here are coaches. And like Coach Tam, she has this very unique way of reaching so many people that she coach. Change doula Tanya Bankston, another life coach, has her gifted way in the way that she pours into people. Then we have Dr. Crystal, who is another life coach that is above and know how to reach back and get those Ruby girls and teach them their worth. And then you have me, who love to empower people to say, you may have some rubies, but let me add more rubies to you because you're special. And so that's what you've done for us tonight. You gave each and every one of us a ruby. So one thing I have to do and say, if it's all right with Tanya Bankston, we love to give shout outs to our fans who write comments and all. We have a fan who is very, very, very supportive of the show. And I want to acknowledge her tonight and say, we see you, we see your comments, and thank you, Ruby Girl.
Yes, yes, yes. I mean, Kay, I can't thank you enough. The Step It Up sisters, the Step It Up
a shout out
leadership group. Okay, Kay has us every Saturday morning up and on the call. We are working. She has we have assignments every single week. We have challenges. She pushes us to do things like our elevator pitch, do things like cleaning up our social media, to do things like monthly challenges and stepping up our business practices. I mean, this leader right here is on it. And I wanted to become a part of the Step It Up group, and I didn't know what I was getting into.
And the thing is, we all just support each other.
Yes.
If somebody got an event, if somebody's on a live, it's anything, you got an audience. You got us behind you.
Yes.
You know, like even Tanya, the fun part is we do a photo shoot. So we go to the Quindicut and we have a ball. We just, you know, take pictures. We're our own photographers and everything. And we wear each other brand. We just support each other. We buy from each other. We push each other. We share resources. It is amazing. The women, I'm telling you, a shout out to my Step It Up group. You are some amazing business women.
Yes. And when she says she's creating millionaires, there are going to be some millionaires in that group. I'm
yes.
believing God, claiming and that every single one of them. But one thing that Kay does that I really, really appreciate, she says, the first one to make that million, provide the opportunity for your sisters in the group to be millionaires.
Yes. We all, one got it, we all got it.
Yes, yes, yes. And I mean, it's just an amazing group where, number one, we first all touch and agree, we all believe in God. That's first and foremost. And then we're in this space where we all support and believe in each other. So when I say she is an amazing leader, she is. And I think about people saying that to be a good leader, you have to do this and do that and do this. First, you have to be a good team player. First, you have to learn to be a good follower behind a good leader. And she's all of that. So yeah, you get a second salute, girl. Salute, salute, salute.
Black to the coaches.
Go ahead. Oh, this is your time.
I have to say this. I want to give all glory to God. It is absolutely not me. I just allow God to lead me and just to have to put the words in my mouth to tell me what to do, and I'm just open to whatever you want to do. But I tell the ladies too, it's not just me. They help me too. I learned so much. Tanya is so hardworking. I'm like, do she sleep? Do she eat? I mean, Tanya, if she doesn't become a millionaire, none of us can become a millionaire. I'm telling you, Tanya is so awesome. I look up to her. I really do. I'm like, how do I get where she's at? She's awesome. So I got to pass the toot the horn back to you, Tanya.
You know, it is so, it feels good to be accessible, you know, to have somebody's number that you can call, because when she makes it, we all make it. But when she makes it, I want her to share it.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. And, you know, the thing that I love, though, about being a part of Kay's ministry and her leadership group is that not one time in the group have I ever felt like jealous of another woman or felt that the need to compete. You know, if there is a woman in the group that needs some type of support, no matter what the support is, Kay has said, okay, do you need help with phone calls? Who's going to help with phone calls? Do you need help with social media or posting? And she gives us assignments to help our sisters. And I think that there's not enough space in our general society where people are actually teammates like that, helping and supporting without that, the need to compete. Because the thing is, there's enough resources for everybody.
So tell us, Sister Kay, where are you now? Where are you going? What is ahead? Are you writing a book? Are you going to be in a movie? Tell us all about it.
I claim it all.
Ask her about that book, because that book is supposed to be finished.
Oops.
Was she talking to me? So, okay. I had a book coach last year. Kim Brooks, shout out to her. Excellent. I wrote 179 pages. I have a book. I actually have a book. I just have to finish it just a little bit more and I'm done with it. But I have to concentrate. And so the book is coming. It's coming. So what I'm doing now, I am training to be a part of Sean's Fair Leadership Tour. It's going to be June the 12th. It's going to be here in Troy, Michigan. And so this is going to be my first public speaker platform with other speakers. So he's training me how to professionally navigate the field. It's an awesome experience because guess what, ladies? I'm also feel like I'm being counseled too, because some of the questions they ask you, it's like you have to look inside yourself and be like, wow, I'm thinking this way when it's really that way. And then, okay, y'all gonna be the first to know, I'm working on opening a boutique in my basement. So I've been posting fashions ever since the pandemic, and I did it so that people can get their minds off being locked in the house. And, you know, I like to look at beautiful things. And ladies, don't we love clothes and pretty nails? And so we couldn't get our nails done, but at least we could look and see some pretty nails and have a vision. And so my hairdresser, Ayana Hall, another shout out, she told me, she said, Kay, you posting these things? She said, why don't you open a boutique? And I have always wanted my own clothing line. I've even had two fashion shows, but I never, like, you know, kind of went there, but I'm going to go there, ladies. I really am. I'm going to push till I reach millionaire status.
Yes. Amen. Amen. And what is the name of the book?
Ruby Girl.
Oh, okay. I didn't know that.
Yes, it's Ruby Girl. It's actually the story of my family. My family has a very interesting story. I mean, even starting from my grandmother. My grandmother died having my mother. And so because my mother died young, I thought I was going to die by the time I was 21. I just thought it was something passed down. And so I thought I broke the cycle by not having kids. I said, the key is if I have kids, I might die young. I said, but if I don't have kids, I'm okay. So it's amazing all the things that happened in my family that affected me, you know, how my thought pattern and everything. But I thank God for the renewal of my mind and the renewal of my soul. I'm telling you, I give all glory to Jesus Christ. It's nothing that I did. He did it all for me. He transformed me. When I tell you, when you become a child of God, you become transformed. That mind is so renewed. So I give him all the glory. None of it. It was none of me doing anything. It was all of him doing everything.
Wow, that right there is just such amazing testimony that you have and that you share with us. I mean, some of the facts that you shared tonight, I did not know. I had not heard before. So I'm sitting here with my mouth open like, oh my God, I never knew that.
And it's funny, when I read her books, I look at her like, Tanya, you sure this happened to you? Because I really, when I first started reading about Tanya's story of abuse, I would sit there and be like, this can't be Tanya. This woman is so polished. This woman is so classy. She is so professional. She is so loving, so kind. It looked like, she don't even look like she's been in a fight a day in her life. So that shows you how God can hide your pain, hide your trauma, dress you up, just like how Eve was presented to Adam. That's how he presents us to the world. And only thing people see is bone of our bone, flesh of our flesh. They don't see what we have been through on the inside, because God dresses us up so beautifully to the world.
Yes, and he renews and restores and revitalizes and refreshes us and prepares us to share our testimony with other people, so that it empowers people to let them know that the enemy is limited in what he can do. And we definitely are empowered by the testimony of other people and sharing our testimony, blowing the enemy out by taking and applying the light to our life. It's those secrets that's kept in darkness that allows the enemy to fester and grow. But when we shine a light on it, it's a wrap. It's a wrap.
And you know, when Tanya talk about shining a light, I call that hidden no more. Because that happened, but that is not who you are. That was part of you. But what you did was expose the enemy for who he was and who he is. And wearing the shirt, Tanya been wearing her shirt and displaying and showing it all night, which I've been unable to show mine. I am so happy to know that if a ruby has been taken from a little girl, but she can get it back. And I just thank God for your story. So tell us, where can we find you? Your web address, your boutique, all those things. Because I'm ready to get this right here so I can put my money up in here.
Look, and Tam, she doesn't have a shirt.
We're gonna get her one.
You can go to my website, rubygirl.net, and order your t-shirts. They are actually on sale for $20. All my shirts are $20. Free shipping. Y'all know y'all love free shipping. And for the bra wallets, you can just basically reach out to me on social media. You can find me. I have a new professional speakers page. It's Karen -- Ruby Girl. Or you can just connect with me on my personal page on Facebook. I'm on Instagram. It's His Designs LLC. Also at Ruby Girl. You can reach me through there. And so that's how you can get in contact with me. I would love to connect and just share my story and empower some of these young ladies and older ladies or any ladies that you are a Ruby Girl. No matter what happened to you, God has already set your value No matter how dusty you get, you still are his precious rubies. And that's what I want women to know. It's not about what you're doing, what you did, or what you done. It's about what God can do in your life. And he can pick you up, dust you off, and make you his beautiful, sparkling ruby girl.
Amen.
His priceless princess.
Yes, I love it. And I love that you said no matter how dusty you are, because see, I'm one of those girls. I'm not one of those pretty little, you know. Hey, I'm one of those kind of like, I've been hard-headed and rough and tough. And so, yeah, that dust, I mean, I need to, you know, and still know that God will, you know.
Well, I'm so glad, because I'm not going to get him. I gotta behave with my own stuff, you know. But I'm so glad too. Hallelujah. You know, don't Google my name. Don't Google it.
I can't wait. Let me Google right now.
Wait a minute. That's why she just say Tamara J.
That's it. Don't Google nothing else, because I'm telling you, the deepest creepers will come out and be like, is this her? Yeah.
That's all right.
I don't believe it. You don't look like that. I'm telling you, God is presenting you as a woman of God.
Yes. And look, at all three of y'all, well, Tamara J, Sister K, ordained minister, Felicia, she got that ministry thing. Bam, 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 ministry.
Oh, Lord Jesus. You know, Sister K, I am sitting here in awe. And I feel the presence. I feel the spirit of the Lord in this place right now. And Sister Tanya, I just have to just be real and keep it real. I'm going to say this right now here live. I'm just so glad that he kept you. I'm so glad that he saved you. I'm so glad that he kept his loving arms around you. I'm so glad that he touched the crown of your head all the way down to your feet so you can walk. I'm so glad that you still have a mouth to talk. I'm still glad that you have all the activities of your limb to be able to raise a hand and say hallelujah. I'm so glad you have feet that you can walk and stomp your feet. I'm so glad that you have eyes that you can see into a person's spirit and tell them that your ruby was once lost, but let me give it back to you. See, people have a past, and people like to remind you of your past. But what you got to tell them is about your future. You got to tell them about the present. So you can tell them, let me just hand you your ruby. You may not want to tell me your ruby been taken, but let me give you your ruby.
Yes.
You know what? Don't get me started.
And see, and Kay, that's what all your brand is about, all of that. Letting a woman know, like you said, your price has already been established. Woo! That right there. Mm. Yes. And I mean, like you said, too many times in today's society, we hear too many other messages about what femininity is about, what being a woman is about, and it's reduced. It's always reduced.
I better jump in here real quick. Look, because I'm on fire right now, and I'm gonna behave. I really am. Y'all don't even have said I gotta turn it down, like, 20 watts right now, because y'all did it. But I sit up and I think about how, you know, Coach Tanya and Miss K, you came on here and you so brilliantly, your brand talks about the ruby, the rock, a stone, like father, like daughter. We are the Ezar Connecto. We are the Chael. We are the warrior. We are the helper, and not help the caretaker. We are father like daughter. There's none like us, and this world has sought to demean and to deny and to dismiss the spirit and the true essence of the one man. But your brand, hallelujah, and I'm trying to calm it down, hallelujah, your brand will do wonders in our time and will begin to restore the inner worth. We're not talking the materialism, but the inner worth, where she will begin to see herself as God sees her. So we praise God for the substance that you are made of, woman of God. We thank him for your anointing. We thank you for the healing virtue. We thank you, hallelujah, for the fire, hallelujah, that you have walked through. We thank you for the angel guides that have been with you, and may they go forward with you in Godspeed. Amen.
Thank you, ladies.
Thank you. Ooh, Sister K.
Yes.
Let me just tell you right now, I don't believe in luck. I don't believe in coincidence. I believe everything is by divine order and divine intervention. It was not by accident that you were at this present, this place, this time, on this show. So many are watching and listening and hearing, and somebody is going to be able to get up, and they're going to dust off the pain. They're going to dust off the sorrow. They're going to dust off the shame. They're going to dust off the embarrassment. And they're going to speak life to them bones. They're going to speak life to their spirit. They're going to speak life to the mind. They're going to speak life. So that's what you did, was you gave us life. Okay? Now, if people don't know what the word life means, they need to look it up. Life means living. Life means going forward. Life means taking a foot in front of the other and keep going. And see, that's what you did. You kept going. You did not lay at the pool and let people just walk over you. You did not the woman, the issue of blood. You're not the person that was diseased and people were just afraid. All you did was, let me touch the hem of his garment and I'll be made whole. You've been made whole because you are Ruby Girl. Your color is red. It is spicy. It is fiery. It is clear. And I don't want you to ever forget it. So when the next time that you're out shopping, I want you to go buy a ruby for yourself, because you deserve it. You are deserving of your own ruby. So instead of you giving one away, I need for you to wear one.
Thank you. Thank you. Y'all have ministered to me tonight. I'm telling you, I needed this. Thank you, ladies. Y'all are awesome.
Yeah. And we need you to come back. We need you to come back after you, your shot. You didn't tell us about that. And you didn't get a chance to tell us about your speaking career, budding, like what your niche is and all. So you got to come back and fill us in on all of those details.
Okay. Yes. I'll come back. Y'all were nice to me.
And when you come back, show us your ruby.
Yeah, I will. I like that.
Make it a big one.
A bling one.
That's right.
Oh, my goodness. So I usually would take us home, but I'm going to give the privilege to my dear baby sister, who's younger than me, and say I'm going to allow her to close out the show tonight. Coach Tamara is in your lap now.
Oh, my. Well, I'm going to tell you, can't nobody do it like Sister Fee do it. And so she has passed me the mic. And we just want to say we want to thank you so much for tuning in and being in this powerful space with us as Miss K, Miss Prophetess K, Miss Minister K has been with us to let us know that we can transform our pain and turn it into purpose. So we are going to tell you that if this is any other broadcast that you watch tonight, you better press replay. Come back and take a second dip. We love you, and get your paintbrush and paint your life and redefine it one more time. So God bless you. We love you. We'll see you next Tuesday.
God bless you. May heaven smile on you.
Good night.
Good night.